that was the situation approved, that you would remove them and put someone in place that will prove what they need to get. Particularly the ears won't get anybody nowhere but the head. And I thank you, Father, for everything you've done for me. Asking now that you give me all my many sins and all the time, Father, that you've told me. Even for those sins, Father, I don't even realize our sins, I ask for forgiveness today.
Yes.
Ask for forgiveness for tomorrow, for what's going to happen tomorrow, that I believe that you're going to do that. You know, my past. Thank you for the past, that you gave me that, and thank you. I thank you for everything, that's every part of it. And I thank you for what's coming. I love you with all my heart. Pray for your name, and ask it all in Jesus' name.
And one of, we need member Terry, Rock and I both talked to him, sir. Terry's had two bad days in a row, and he's really had a bad day today, so. Left Terry up again, every time we think he's coming back on a roll, it seems like something tries to knock him down. He's got such a positive attitude, and I thank God for him, and ask that you pray very much for him.
Good evening, church.
Good evening.
Good to see all of you this evening. Isn't God good? You know, it's easy to praise God when things are going good, but you know, you got to know that, and I'm speaking from experience here, you know, that God wonders where you're going to praise Him in the thick of the thick. But, you know, I know God allows things to come up on us, we go through things. But you know, it, in all honesty, it's not always easy to praise God during those times. But I do believe we got to push through, and He's always there for us. I mean, He don't promise us that things ain't going to happen, but He does promise that He'll be there with us to get them through. And I know He's going to hold up His end of the deal. And I just thank God for that we got Him to lean on in these times and struggles that we go through. You know, I look back now and I think, man, how in the world did I ever make it without Him? You know, but just thank God for Him. And just thank God we can still come together like we are and just worship and praise Him together. Amen. We're going to start out tonight on page 14. There's power in the blood.
There is power, power, one.
page 20. He lives.
Thank you. Christian won't get along.
Don, now is the time to worship.
Time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are.
Come.
One day
I'm going a different direction tonight. And you probably ain't gonna like it, but I'm going there anyway. But I do want to read the last part of that message that I started this morning in Luke chapter 1. The past part that I didn't finish, and I'm not going to stay there, I just want to read it to you, because it's very important. It tells us who, I told you John the Baptist was filled with the Holy Ghost, and that last miracle that I talked about, one of the last miracles, was Zechariah was filled with the Holy Ghost and prophesied, but it didn't tell you what he said. It said he prophesied saved. So here's what he prophesied right here. He said it. In Luke chapter 1, the last, 67 through 80. Listen to what he said. This is him. This is Zechariah preaching. He said, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people." Isn't that the truth? "And has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. He spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy," we talked about that in Sunday school this morning, "promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he sware unto our father Abraham, that he would grant unto us, that we being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And thou, child," this is Zechariah talking, "shall be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy," there it is, "of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit and was in the deserts till the day of his showing unto Israel." That's John the Baptist. That's what Zechariah preached. Now we'll switch gears for just a minute, and I won't keep you long. Turn with me to the other book that he wrote. Y'all wasn't here this morning. You don't know what I'm talking about. What did I tell you? How many books did I tell you he wrote?
Acts.
The book of Acts. Acts chapter 5. Not a very popular subject. Nobody wants to hear about this much because it offends us when we talk about this. Because we sometimes, we don't have that problem here. But I have seen it prevalent in other churches. I call it spiritual pretenders. You ever known a spiritual pretender? Well, let's just read the scripture. Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5. "But a certain man named Ananias with Sapphira and his wife sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter's the preacher, said, Ananias, why has Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? While it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart, that thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God? And Ananias, hearing those words, fell down and gave up the ghost, and great fear came on all them that heard these things. And the young men arose, wound him up, and carried him out, and buried him. And it was about the space of 3 hours after, when his wife, not knowing what was done, came in. And Peter answered unto her, Tell me whether you sold the land for so much. And she said, Yea, for so much. Then Peter said unto her, How is it that ye have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of them which have buried thy husband are at the door, and shall carry thee out. Then fell she down straightway at his feet, and yielded up the ghost. And the young man came in, and found her dead, and carried her forth, and buried her by her husband. And great fear came upon all the church, and upon as many as heard these things." Father, thank you tonight. realize this particular passage of scripture right here. God's sign. Sometimes, Lord, we read this and we have to ask ourselves this question. God, am I pretending in some way in my life? Is there something that I'm faking, God? Is there something to fake about me that needs to become real? Lord, I pray that we'd all ask those questions in our heart and make sure of our salvation tonight. Make sure that we're on the same page with God. God, help us not to lie to the Holy Spirit. We can lie to men all day long, but we can't lie to God. God knows. Father, I thank you for such peace and knowledge we have tonight. I thank you, God, for a church that worships you with truth and spirit. One that's really sold out to you, God. That's who these people are tonight, God, and I realize that. Father, I thank you for the prayers and all that they do for you. God, bless your people tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Zechariah back there in chapter 1 was declaring the greatness of John the Baptist, the likes of which we haven't seen in our lifetime. We call some people John Wesley, Billy Graham, others that you know we call them Christ or those type of people, and we see them in the great revivals over the years that we've seen, and they come in the spirit of the Lord, and we understand that God moves upon those people, and Zechariah, him prophesying that and telling us who John the Baptist would become, and he did become that. He went out to the desert, stayed in the desert, and people came with great fear and trembling to the River Jordan to hear John preach. And what he preached? He preached repentance. You must be born again. You must be baptized. And he didn't cut no slack about it. He preached hard and strong. He didn't care who you were, what kind of position you had, what kind of authority you had. He preached to them. As a matter of fact, a bunch of the Pharisees went out there and he called them a bunch of vipers. That's what he said. He said, y'all are a bunch of snakes. He said, you come out here. What seek you when you come out here? A reed shaking in the wind? He said, you're looking for some kind of sign? He said, the only sign I got for you is Jesus Christ is coming, and he's coming up real quick. You better look around behind you because he's on the way. And I love John the Baptist and how he did it. And so John prepared the way for Jesus. Jesus came, and we'll get into more into the Christmas message a little. Let me fast forward just a little bit. Jesus lived his life 33 and a half years. They put him on the cross. He died, and he rose again. But before he left, as he departed from this world, going back to his home in heaven, he told his disciples, he said, marvel not that you see me depart. He said, but I send you another comforter. That's what he said, another comforter. In other words, he was a comfort while he was here, but I'm sending you another comfort that will live in you. In other words, and here's the difference in that. Jesus, while he was here, he healed the blind, the halt, the lame. He did all of that, but they had, most of the time, they had to come to where Jesus was. And that's what they did, just like John the Baptist. They flocked to wherever Jesus was. Or if he was coming to their town, they would get together and be where Jesus was. But when he sent his other comforter, they didn't have to do that anymore, because that comforter is all over, it's everywhere, and it can be had simply by faith tonight. That's the good news. That's why Jesus said, I can't be everywhere at once while I was here. I must go back, but the one I'm going to send is going to be everywhere and for every need. It's going to guide your life. It's going to tell you how to live. It's going to correct you when you start doing things wrong. It's going to guide you in every facet of your life. And folks, if you don't realize it yet, the Holy Spirit that lives in you does exactly that. It does. So, he sends the comforter, and that's Acts chapter 2. That's when the church is birthed, and the Holy Spirit is given. The Holy Ghost comes down with tongues of fire, and they begin speaking in other languages and tongues, and everybody around understands. And so the church is birthed. Now, the church, this church,
was much, I think, much like this church, because if you back up and read in chapter 4 of Acts, it says that they had all things in common, and they were all of one mind and one accord. That's what it said right there in the verses just before you. I read those to you in Acts chapter 5. In other words, that church was in tune with God. But they were facing persecution on every hand. This early church, see, y'all know what persecution is. That church was persecuted. There was people killed for claiming to be a Christian in that day. And we don't understand, we can't even fathom that. Not in this country, but in third world countries. If you go somewhere where it's really dangerous to live as a Christian, you'll know what I'm talking about. And so, the church was burned. And the church was standing strong against sin. I wish that every church would stand strong against sin today. We're so lackadaisical about sin anymore in the mainstream church of America today that sin isn't, they don't even call it sin anymore. They call it a misdemeanor in faith, I guess what you'd call it, or something like that. They just dismiss it and say, well, everybody's doing it. It must not be that bad. I don't care if everybody's doing it. If God says it's sin, it's sin. It's black and white. Amen. And so the church is birthed and the church is being persecuted, but the church is standing strong. Even though they're being persecuted, even though some are being killed, the church is bound together, and thousands are coming to the church and gathering at the church. And just before I read this in chapter 4, the last part of 4, it says that they all came together, and it said those that had possessions, houses and land, they sold some of their possessions and laid it at the apostles' feet, and they distributed it to the people that needed something. Now, if that ain't a picture of a true church, I don't know what it is. Because that's the way the church is supposed to operate, ladies and gentlemen. Now, that doesn't mean, some people interpret that, well, you mean I got to sell my house and my car and my garage? I got to sell everything? No, it said those that had possessions. In other words, they had extra possessions that they wasn't using. It was just sitting there. And they said, I'm going to sell this parcel of land, and I'm going to give it to the church so that somebody that needs something can have something. Can I tell you tonight, per capita, and I don't ever look at stuff, but from year to year I look at it. I dare say, for a church with 100 or 150 or 200 people, well, there before the pandemic we were running almost 200, for a church your size, I'd go out on a limb and say that you have given more to this community than any other church in our community. I go out on it and say that. Per capita. Because you love to give. You love the Lord. And I understand that. And that's a good thing. But that church, they laid the money at the apostles' feet. And Ananias and Sapphira is sitting here watching this. And Ananias and Sapphira are saved. Don't misunderstand this. They were saved. And they were watching when Barnabas came there in the last part of chapter 4, and Barnabas had sold a piece of ground, and he brought the money and he laid it at the apostles' feet, and they took it and distributed it to those that were in need. Ananias and Sapphira said, hey, that's a good idea. Let's do that. Let's sell. We got an extra piece of ground. Let's sell it, honey. And we'll take it and get it. But here's their thing. They got a new life center over there at that church. This is the first church, by the way. I don't know if that's a life center or not, but I just say to you. And you know, if we give a little bit of that money, and if we hold back, we don't have to give it all to them, honey. But if we give it, it'll make us look good. And they might name that wing at that fellowship hall after us. Yeah. See, they were seeking after the notoriety.
Right.
It wasn't, to them, the giving wasn't really important. They could have given it all. It didn't matter. And they had that choice. But they chose to scheme together against God and say, we're going to look at what we've done. We've given this amount of money, and they thought, because see, they was jealous of Barnabas. Yeah, they looked at what he did and they said, well, we can do that. And it'll make us look good. Everybody's looking up to Barnabas. Everybody's looking up to them people that had enough to give. And so we've got it too. And so let's do it. And the church will think more of us. And I tell you tonight, the most special people under God's watch are the ones that give and you never know their name. They never want any recognition. They don't want any notoriety. They don't want a wing named after them. They don't want anything. They want God to be glorified in the gifts that they give, because they know that they've been blessed by an almighty God, one that saved their soul from sin, one that has got them on a path of righteousness, and they want nothing in return. They, because they've already got their reward in salvation. They're a child of God. The money don't mean anything to them. And that's the way Ananias and Sapphira should have been. But it said they schemed together and said, let's just give part of the money. Let's keep back. We might need it, but our grandkids are going to need that for their living later on, because they're too lazy to work. Amen. And so they kept back a part of that money. But watch what happened. When they came and laid it at Peter the preacher's feet, the Holy Ghost began to speak to Peter. See, they didn't realize how in tune with God Peter was. They didn't realize that Holy Ghost that they just lied to between the two of them could interpret the thoughts of men. And Peter, he wasn't having none of it. He said, listen here. He said, why did you conceive this scheme and want to lie to the Holy Ghost? You ain't lying to us. You're lying to God.
Yeah.
You know, we do things that are pretty stupid sometimes in our life. I've done a lot of stupid things. But one of the things that I never, ever have done is lie to the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
And I never, I can't remember ever taking my Lord's name in vain. I said a lot of bad things in my life, but I cannot ever remember saying that word. I just couldn't do it. Even though I was lost, I couldn't do it. Because I knew that there was a God. So, here these two people, for whatever reason, now I'm just telling you that because it sounds good. And I don't know that they wanted their name on a wall. I don't know they wanted their name on a plaque. But the reason they lied, they didn't lie to men. They lied to the Holy Ghost. They lied to God. And God was having, see, he had to protect his first church. His church had to be pure. He wanted them to withstand. And if he had let this go, sin would have started running rampant in the church. You see, when sin starts in the church, you've got to cut it off. You've got to head it at the pass. Because if the preacher lets sin run rampant in the church is going to fall apart. It's going to become a disaster. Why do you get too many amens there? See, y'all ain't too bad. I can preach to you about sin, and it don't hurt your little feelings. Because y'all know it's true. If I got up in front of the first church of the Frozen, and preach like I do in front of y'all, it would offend them. Man, they would tell me, boy, we don't want you back over here. Now. We don't want to hear it. We want to hear a soft, easy sermon. One that'll just set our hearts ablaze. And we can go home with a warm, fuzzy feeling and feel good about going to church. Listen, if you feel good about going to church, it ain't because I'm tickling your ears. It's because the Holy Ghost is speaking to your heart. And you know that sin is in your life. And you know that you need God to cut that stuff out of your life. That's the truth tonight. You don't need to hold it against me. And you listen, if you don't like what I say, you take it up with God. I'm just telling you what God said from his word. Ananias and Sapphira, they lied. And Peter said, why did you conceive this? It was yours. You could have done with it whatever you wanted to. You didn't have to sell us anything. But they told of a certain price, and they lied. God said, I've seen enough. He didn't form a jury. He didn't hold a trial. Oh, Ananias, he said, son, you're in trouble. And he fell down right then and yielded up the ghost. God killed him right there. I remember, I need some Bible reading tonight. If you go back to Judges chapter 7, you'll find that the Israeli people went into a certain village. And God told them, he said, I'm going to give you victory, and you're going to reap a great spoil. You're going to take in all kinds of stuff. He said, but don't you take that stuff. Don't you touch that. He said, you leave it alone. That's mine. Well, there was an old boy named Achan that saw some pretty Babylonian robes and a pile of silver and a pile of gold, and he took it and he buried it in his tent, thinking nobody would know. He was looking around, but he wasn't looking up. And God knew exactly where it was, and he said, cast lots there, old boy, Josh. He said, Joshua, cast some lots, and see, you've got sin in the camp. You need to find out where that stuff is. And he cast the lots, and it fell on Achan, and they called Achan up to the committee of Joshua's the jury there, and he said, why? What have you done? He didn't know how they knew. See, the Holy Ghost was real even then. And it hadn't even come yet. God revealed it. He said, yeah, that was me. He said, it's over in the tent, under the tent, buried. He said, go get it. Bring your family with you, by the way, when you come bring it back.
Oh, yeah.
He said, bring all that you hid, all that you stole, that you wasn't supposed to take. Bring it with you when you come back. He brought all his family, all his kids, all his grandkids, all his animals. He brought everything he had, and they gathered them up, and God killed them. Every one of them. See, when we sin, it doesn't just affect you. It affects everybody, and you can't lie to God. Oh, you say, well, I've been lying pretty good to it. I got away with it for years. And, you're going to stand before God one day. And I believe he's going to have a big old screen. And your whole life is going to roll in there before you. He said, what was you thinking there? Yeah, when you lied there, what was you thinking there? When you done that, what was you thinking over there? I've done give you eternal life, and here you are. What was you doing? What was you thinking doing that against me there? But God is a God of mercy. You see, every one of us deserved to die. Ananias died right on the spot. Now, he should have took his wife with him when he went. I don't know why she wasn't in church when he was. He was there, but she wasn't. I got a good imagination. If she lied to the church, if she lied, she probably lied to him where she was at. I don't know. Maybe she was putting on her makeup and took a 3 hours. I don't know. I better not even go down that road. I'll just go ahead and say it. Did you know that the Bible says that women are not to adorn themselves with all kinds of jewelry?
Amen.
That won't cost you anything else for you. She comes in 3 hours later. And Peter asked her the same question the preacher asked her. Did you agree to bring that amount of money? Did y'all sell that land for that amount of money? She said, yeah, we did. She was lying through her teeth. She knew what they got for the land. But she knew what they agreed to give to the church. And he said, honey, he said, the same old boy that carried your husband out 3 hours ago, they're back there at the back door waiting on you right now. And she fell down
damn as she could be.
Now you say, well, that seems awful harsh. That's a harsh judgment. Listen, when you lie to the Holy Ghost, you're on dangerous ground. I don't care who you are. And so these two were killed. But mine goes back to 2 Samuel. When David, remember when David was trying to bring the Ark of the Covenant home? He went up to, that's where he left it, at Obadiah's house. But just before that, he went and got the Ark out of the Philistine country at Bathsheba. And he's bringing it home on a new cart, it says. And the ox stumbled. And Uzziah and Ahio was handling the stock. And the cart, it looked like it was going to fall off this cart. Well, they knew that nobody was supposed to touch that ark. They knew that it had to be handled by the priest. But he stuck out his hand out of instinct and touched that Ark of the Covenant. I watched the Raiders of the Lost Ark last night. He found it, by the way. Didn't y'all see the movie?
Yeah.
Well, he said he did. I don't know. Anyway, so when he touched that ark, right there at the threshing floor of Chidon, God killed him. Right. Now that scene, David got mad at God. He said, God, I don't know how to carry you anywhere. Your presence is in this ark. I don't know what I'm going to do. That's when he took it to Obadiah. And y'all know that story. But see, throughout the Bible, people that sin directly against God, God killed them.
Yeah.
He had no mercy on them because they knew what God said. And so, in this case, the Bible says that Ananias and Sapphira were carried out of the church and buried because they lied to the Holy Ghost. How many times, if you think back in your life, how many times have you and I lied to God? How many times have we tried to make a deal? Remember that show, Let's Make a Deal?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. We talk to God and say, well, God, I didn't really mean that. But it looked good, and I wanted to do it anyway. God, let's make a deal. If you'll forgive me, God, I forgive you for letting me do it. Yeah. Yeah, that's kind of our mentality sometimes. God don't play like that. See, when you sin against God, it's a rough ordeal. I tell you, when you sin against God, it's one thing to sin against me, and I can forgive you. Maybe. I'm supposed to forgive you. But when you sin against God, God takes it serious. He really does. And so, which when you combine all of this and you look at the whole picture, the church had been birthed. The church was growing by leaps and bounds. People were coming to the church by the thousands, the hundreds, and they were getting saved, and they were seeing. If you read down right where I left off in chapter 5, right after that, and it said, and the apostles were given power to heal the sick, fix the lame, so that they could walk. The blind was being restored to their sight. And those apostles were given great power. Why? Because they would not tolerate sin. They stayed true to God, and that God had a message from God, that God was truly in charge, and they wanted nothing in credit for their life, and they were moving, and said even they'd take out napkins and handkerchiefs, and people would come, and they would touch their napkins and be healed of their disease. You see, they had great power, and that power wasn't theirs. It was God's, and God had set them out. Listen to me today. That same power is available today to you and I if you and I would truly get in touch with God and lay everything at God's feet and say, God, I need your power. I need your mercy. I need your grace so that I can see people saved and see people healed. This church, when I read that, I think about this church every time. Because over the last 15 years, I have seen this church reach out. See, a church is not, let me ask you this. If our church ceased to function, if we closed the doors next week, would anybody notice? I mean, besides y'all, in our community, would they even know that we're open? See, somebody came to me last week, and I hadn't seen them in a while. And they said, well, what are you doing now? I said, well, I'm still running the restaurant, and I pastor a church down in Frankenburg. Oh, you do? Well, how long have you been down there? Well, I've been there 15 years. Well, I didn't know. You see what I'm saying? See, sometimes we're not having the impact that we need to be having out in the community. People need to know who we are. We need to be out working in the community and interlocking ourselves in the community and standing against the things that are wrong in our community. Why do you think we have such an outpouring of you people when they started introducing and we want to sell alcohol all over the county and in the city? Why do you think that room was filled up with people from Pryorsburg Methodist Church? I'll tell you why. Because you, like the early church, are going to stand against sin. It doesn't matter who likes it. We're going to stand and declare the Word of God, what the Word of God says, and the truth is the truth. They may not believe it, they may not like it, and they may not want to know you at all. But listen, if you'll stand on the truth of the Word of God, God will honor that in your life.
Amen.
Ananias and Sapphira were spiritual contenders. They acted all spiritual, but they were lying. There's people that go to church every Sunday that are spiritual pretenders. They want to be seen in the congregation. They maybe want to be seen in the choir. There's some preachers that are spiritual pretenders. They want to be seen in the pulpit and heard in the pulpit, but their life out there tells a different story. You hear me tonight? We cannot be found spiritual. There's nothing that can be fake about us. Why do you think Jesus saved you? So that you could show the world that you belong to Christ. And if you're faking it, if you're a spiritual pretender tonight, you're in deep trouble. Because you may fool me for 15 years, but you ain't fooled God for 1 second. He knows exactly where you're at tonight. Oh, listen. We lie about a lot of things. Dennis and I swap lies every Sunday morning. Well, sometimes.
Tell it like it is.
Well, let me put it this way. We want to see who can come up with the biggest story.
I'm with it.
But in all reality, we need to be out there in the community showing them that we truly believe in the Word of God. And we're standing on the Word of God and nothing else. Nothing else in our life should matter except what Jesus is doing in our lives. Come on, pray this. Where are you at tonight? Are you a spiritual pretender? Do you think that you can just walk through this life and go to church every Sunday and Sunday night and Wednesday night and you can fool God and say, well, I'm your child, God. God's sitting up there saying, I don't even know your name. Be a sad day for a lot of people when you have to stand before Holy God. Would you stand with
me? 259, what a friend.
You come tonight. Let God have His way in your heart tonight.
Thank you.
I told you I wouldn't keep you very long tonight. I hope you have a wonderful week this week as we head into the Christmas season. We're looking at some good things. We got our Christmas play next Sunday morning. And the Sunday following that, nothing changes. I'm going to call Bubba Smith. Bubba's going to come preach that Sunday morning. If I can get him over here. He's been wanting to come preach. You'll love him. He's a good man. God has restored his life. Yes, ma'am.
Mick, you said a moment ago about if the church was to close the door completely, who would know about it?
Yeah.
Now, I've only been here a short while. I ain't been here like Mick yet and everything. But since I've been here, I have heard the stories like everybody else has gone out. But I'll tell you right now, there's a lot of children at Christmas time that wouldn't have gotten something just because of our little change.
That's right.
What
happened. That's right.
The backpack program, lunches, and stuff like that. If you don't think for 1 minute they wouldn't miss that, you're mistaken.
Amen.
They see the things that come out of this little congregation. I don't know what I'm talking about. But this church in Fryersburg, Kentucky, we may not be a big shining light and everything, but there are some people that would definitely miss this little congregation.
Amen.
And I'll tell you one thing, I am proud to be part of it.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I am too.
I don't care about Mickey that much.
I love you too, brother. All right. That fried chicken was good today. All right. I'm going to go home and see if I can find a piece of it. Oh, actually, I'm headed today. I've got one more service to do today. Y'all pray for us. All right. Well, we're dismissed this week.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we just love you. We thank you. We praise you, Father. Lord, we just acknowledge that you are God. And Lord, Father, there's many of us here, Lord, that you've proven to us that you love us. You continue to bless us, Father. Lord, you continue to forgive us. You continue moving in our life, Father. Lord, let me say that you are the most, and your presence is the most important thing in our life, Father. Lord, I thank you for this. Father, concerning, Lord, the Supreme Court and what's going on in our nation, Lord, what a wrong it's been done, Father. Lord, my heart breaks for these babies, Lord. My heart breaks, Father, for, Lord, how this country has conducted itself, Father. Lord, I just pray that you would turn us around, Lord. Father, that you would give us that chance, Lord. Father, most of all, Lord, let those of us that's called by your name, Father, Lord, let us get right with you, Father. Lord, let us, Father, get in line, Lord. Father, clean us up, Father. Put us up on that hill, Lord. Father, let your light shine through us, Lord, a long ways and touch that lost and dying world, Father. Lord, place your power in us, Father. Lord, let us be found going about in our community, Lord. Father, touching lives, Father. Those that you've placed in our lives, Father, in our workplaces, Lord. Father, our family, Father. Our fathers, our mothers, our sons, our daughters, our brothers, our sisters, Father. Lord, reach out and touch them, Father. Put someone in their path, Father, that can be a minister to them, Lord. Father, draw them to you, Father. Lord, we'll be found always giving you all the honor and the glory and the praise. In your blessed name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you.